I have been working in the NGO sector for last 20 years, and the major challenges which we see today are data, documentation and dashboard. If you talk about data, data is every project creates humongous amount of data, whether it is beneficiary data or data in regards to information which is gathered. This is one of the first challenge which every NGO or a corporate foundation faces. The second important pain statement of every NGO is a lot of documentation is created before the project is started, during the project and after the project is completed. Now, these documents to be maintained has become a compliance today, and that is a challenge. Previously, it was more for the sake of documentation, creating historical record. But now with the coming of the CSR law, it has become a compliance and which needs to be reported to the different ministries under which different projects or different domains are taken. And the most important part, which is the third pain point, is once the data is collected, it needs to be shown, or if the documents are maintained, they need to be shown somewhere. So dashboard, which is different for different stakeholders, is a very big challenge. Everyone maintains data, everyone maintains document, but one single platform where you can actually put both of them together and display it in the way a stakeholder typically wants it. Typically a project have different stakeholders. One is maybe the donor, who would like to see data in a different format, to look into his social investment, how the social investment is showing change. Second may be the NGO who is implementing the project for them. They would require a dashboard to actually monitor and evaluate whether the projects are going according to the timelines, are they moving the way it has been planned, is the amount of money which is sanctioned has been used properly. So that requires a single dashboard where all these figures can actually be seen. And third, I would say the beneficiary today is also asking for, if he is going to share any data, he is asking what happened about his data. So that also becomes the most important point. Till date, most of the projects were towards the donor and the NGO. The beneficiaries were not asking. Every beneficiary is asking, if I have to share even 10 data points, he says, what is for me? So that becomes a challenge for every donor or an NGO. How is he going to show that data to the beneficiary, and how is it going to benefit the outcomes of the entire project? And last but not the least are compliance agencies, which are government, which may be government organization or institutions where the trusts are registered. They also are looking into actually data mining, finding what has happened to the social investment which is done by corporates. So that is, so we are looking at four different stakeholders in the entire scenario, and these are the challenges which are faced for all these years. And now the challenges have become even getting higher in terms of complexity, because every project has so many things to be delivered.
Nitin has explained that there is a lack of effective data collection and collaboration tools in the market. The reason because that the social sector was quite been neglected by technology, because they were working more on a ground level and they were more focused towards delivering the services. But as he said that after the introduction of the CSR law, it has become a very mandatory for all organizations to complete a compliance reports and produce it to the government. What is my observation is that there are many big players are now getting into it, but still at this moment people are still doing or providing a technology services in silos. You know, some people are only providing a survey tools, some people are providing only the platform to manage it, and there are a lot of technology companies at a device management level, they are working on a ground level. So at this moment still technology adoption is not done, but still I would say there is a lot of scope is there. I'm sure that NGOs, corporates, and even beneficiaries, they are more looking at it more a robust technology solution which will reduce their load of generating reports and giving the compliance reports to government. So there's a holistic approach has to be done. That's what I feel at this moment. To answer your question about what existing technologies have been used, I would say that in our observation, majorly NGOs are still using Excel reports to gather beneficiary data. They have some internal teams by which they generate MIS reports out of that. Some of them are a little bit technology savvy, they started using Google Forms, or there are small vendors who are providing survey applications. So they have started using that. I would say corporates are still using Excel reports to do a project management for each and every initiative. Some of them are using some finance system like Tally or some internal ERP systems to keep records of all the financial transactions. But still, this has been nascent at this moment, and people are still using the rudimentary ways of capturing data, maintaining records as of now. And as Nitin said, that more than 30% of the time has been spent on generating reports because the data is not real time. Data has been done manually at the ground level. Ideally, it has to reach within 1 or 2 days, but it's taking more than 1 month to reach to a corporate. So that's the major challenge all corporates and NGOs are facing it at this moment. Basically, at this moment, if you see that there are more than 15,000 corporates who fall under the CSR category, and there are more than 30 lakhs of NGOs who are actually supporting those initiatives. So there is a lot of information has been captured that has to be converted into reports and also for impact analysis purpose. So there are that's a need for corporates and NGOs and most of the stakeholders, and for even for funders and donors. So there are many organizations are trying to see how this requirement can be, you know, fulfilled. There are some players are getting into it, and as I said in the previously that, but they are still doing it part by part. You know, some. Organizations, they have started providing platforms for managing CSR life cycle. There are some people are providing only the fund management kind of a platforms. There are some organization only providing the survey applications. So that's what I feel, that still people realize that there is a need and there is a definitely a solution is required, but it's still too early. I would say that the people are still trying to experiment and see that, you know, what kind of a perfect solution can apply to this particular sector.
When we talk about technology in the CSR sector and why we are here, the most important point here is that we come with 20 years of experience in the social sector, especially behavioral change. And what we have found as a challenge has become our product offering. Right from designing a project, whether it's a social project or any typical project, it has its life cycle, right? From taking a survey, understanding the, having a need-based survey, understanding the requirement of the beneficiary, rather than pushing something which we want to offer to the beneficiary. So the first product is a survey tool which actually helps to understand the ground realities of a typical village or a requirement of a village, requirement of the community, requirement of an individual, and then making the corporate understand that it's not just building toilets which should change them or impact them. It is not just working in isolation like providing a school which has an internet connection and has an e-learning platform which is not going to help. So this survey tool actually helps to understand what are the requirements of a village. After marking the requirements, the corporate can go to the next level of what do they want to deliver and how they can make it as an integrated project in the overall development of a village. The next tool which we have is a complete, once a project is designed, in terms of the survey is done on the need based, you need to actually make a project management possible, right from understanding the facts and figures of the project, who are the beneficiary or the target audience, what is the age of the target audience, what are the economic status of the target audience, what are their expectations from the project, what are the key performance indicators, what is the risk to the project. So this entire thing is mapped onto a single project management tool. The next level it goes for, we have something called an approval system. Now typical an approval system, it takes 2 to 3 months because we send one email to 10 people and their 10 people respond, and it goes for 2-3 months, and that 2-3 months actually creates hundreds of emails and hundreds of Word files or Excels. On our tool, it just comes in a one single format. Those people who need to approve it gets the mail or a notification, and they go on a chat mode, and it actually helps them to figure out what is right and wrong, and there is no duplication of the same comments done by everyone. So this is the second part of our project management tool. Third is the implementation parts. When the approval are done, we have something which actually gives milestone to each project team members so that he gets a notification and he creates his task list. So that helps actually the project team also to understand what is meant for him in this project. It gives him a guideline what he needs to deliver, in how much time he needs to deliver, and what would be the cost typically to deliver. The next level is the budget. Now typically every project, the amount is sanctioned at one go, but the funding comes in maybe on a monthly cycle or a quarterly cycle or end of certain milestones. So this is actually captured in our project management tool. And last but not the least is the reporting online. So we have a mechanism whereby whatever is done to a project is typically everything is online, and a donor or a project manager or the implementing partner can go online and check using his login, and based on his rights he gets to see what he needs to see. So this actually takes care of a lot of things in terms of the managing of the entire projects, creating more transparency, creating compliance, and everyone is happy in terms of reducing the workload of reporting every time. People keep on reporting, like writing reports. Here no one writes reports. They do their task, and the task actually create reports. So that mechanism is there whereby it helps in actually increasing the capacity or enhancing the performance by 30-40% in a typical project life cycle. So these are some of the tools which are there. We have even operational apps for, like, financial inclusion is one of the largest project which is taken in this country. We have another is skill building and livelihood, which is another domain which everyone is spending a lot of money. And the most important part is the third, which is an integrated village development. So we have operational apps on all of these, and these apps actually connect the project management tool with the operational ground realities, how the data is captured. And in real time, the operational apps provide feeds to the project management tool, which the corporates are able to see everything in real time. In terms of the technology part, I think Nilesh will be able to highlight how we are using these. And
So if you see that the complete life cycle of any initiative, it starts with the baseline of catching a demographic survey. So we have a mechanism to do that. We have a mechanism to analyze it. Once the need has been created, after that there is a need for a fund. So we have a donor management system which takes care of a complete life cycle or complete workflow of getting fund. So right from the creating a fund request, fund approvals, proposal making, everything, you know, till disbursement, everything can be captured over there. Once the fund is available, then the next important, we have a CSR platform which takes care of a complete project management life cycle, right from a planning of particular project, planning of operations, after that capturing the milestones, implementations, closing, everything right from the approvals, and also having a dashboards to see which projects are doing, you know, how the progress reports of that. At the same time, after a completion, during a completion of the project, we have operational tools for different initiatives. You know, for example, we have an operation tool for financial inclusion, we have for livelihood and skill building, we also have for integrated village adoption, and there are many more, you know, particular. So if you see that right from getting a baseline till actually delivering any initiative, we have tools available for a complete life cycle of it. That's what I have to say.
Yeah, in terms of your question, how our platform is solving problems for our clients, we would like to mention CRISIL Limited, in which we are helping CRISIL Foundation on the financial inclusion program in Assam. Their target 3 years back was 1 lakh household, and the challenge was Assam with typical problems of internet connectivity, transportation, language. So what we did was, after having a small reiki or a visit at various locations in Assam, we came out with an app which actually works without internet connectivity, which actually stores data, and whenever they are in connectivity, this data gets uploaded. CRISIL's challenge was 140 people on the field every day for 3 years. And how do I actually understand what is my 140 people doing? This app actually does a real-time reporting whenever they are in internet connectivity, in terms of easy conducting a survey, or easy doing a linkage, easy having a community, I would say, event, easy linking an beneficiary to a bank, or easy helping them to understand insurance, easy helping different stakeholders which they have mapped on the survey tool to connect each other. So CRISIL, on a day-to-day basis, when they started, used to get almost 100 to 200 calls to the project manager to say, ki, what am I doing for a day? Today, no one calls. Everyone is doing his task, and his task itself becomes a report, and it is auto-generated. And CRISIL Foundation management sitting in Mumbai can actually see the dashboard. Today they have reached 1 lakh household, and they have a complete dashboard in terms of, in Assam, how many people are banked, how many people have insurance, how many people have taken pension, how many people are exposed to risk, with their livelihood at risk in terms of no insurance, if they have a furlough or if they have any livestock, and if it is not insured. So the counseling to this project become very specific. The counseling become specific to the family, because every family data is taken, and it creates a financial health card which actually talks about, okay, your income, total family income is 10,000. How much are you spending? You're spending 8,000. And what are you spending? You're spending on essential, non-essential, very essential. So the person who goes on the field does a one-to-one counseling, and he actually shows them where is he spending more, where he can save, and if he saves, what would be the right format or formal sources where he can save. So thereby reducing the risk of his investment or his money being actually at a threat, or being used on a day-to-day basis, or being invested in a Ponzi scheme and never getting the money back. So this app actually has become a very important tool for delivering the whole program. CRISIL have become successful in Assam, and the same tools are now taken in Rajasthan and now even in Maharashtra. We are happy for CRISIL for giving us this opportunity for using our platform, because they were the early users and we had a lot of learning from them. We are working on a similar model with a lot of clients, like we are working with ICICI Foundation for their skill building and livelihood training. We are working with Humana, people to people, on their back to school project. We are working with BIEF on integrated village development. We are working with WWF, Worldwide Fund, on their environmental project. We are working with Impact India on their adolescent girl child program, and a lot of even village-based small initiatives in terms of good governance, which they are delivering in Maharashtra. We are working with one of the most enterprising NGOs called Mandeshi also. Mandeshi has a very good format in which they actually help women who are vendors, like vegetable vendors, or basically in the rural areas where no one is ready to give them any type of finance. So Mandeshi has a very good format where they actually do financial and digital literacy. They take them to the level of, they have something called a Chamber of Commerce, where they introduce them to the skills of marketing and training. And our app actually maps every progress which has done in terms of the beneficiary, whether that beneficiary today has a bank account, has she taken a loan, has she has any assets in her own name. So these social indicators are also mapped, which creates the project impact much, much more qualitative than the quantitative part. We also are working on Sri Mukti Sangatana, who are a Mumbai-based NGO, and they work for the rights of ragpickers, who are one of the most neglected community. In fact, Bombay, I think without ragpickers would be something which we can't imagine. So we were lucky enough to get very good projects, very good organizations to work with. We have worked with Arman in terms of delivering their Women and Child, the 1000 Days Project, and Yuva Pratishtan, or Kherwadi Welfare.
Which is the Kherwadi Social Welfare Association. We are working with them to completely autonomize their recent operations, which they are doing it for camps, centers, for partnerships. They are working also with the social worker. So right from the mobilization, from the batch creation, batch operations, closing, assessments, certification, everything, the complete life cycle of any skill building program, which we have automized it, and in the application, the data of the beneficiary is captured using Android applications now. So that's what we have been working with many customers as of now, many NGOs, foundations as of now. So at SynergyConnect, we exclusively work in social sector. Both of us, we come with a very strong, I would say, combined 50 years of experience. So our aim is basically to provide affordable and easy applications to this sector, so that what are the great work they have been doing it for the great causes, that has to be, you know, properly evaluated, and beneficiaries should get the benefits for this. So basically, I would say that in SynergyConnect, our tagline is what?
Yeah, data talks.
Data talks. And that's what we have realized, that data is everything. And let's help most of the foundations, corporates in this sector to give them the best services. That's why we are here.
Thank you.
Thanks.